Welcome to the new session of the Fourier Transforms. So today we shall be discussing the Fourier sine and cosine transforms. So the Fourier sine and cosine transforms are very important, and the results of the Fourier sine transform and the Fourier cosine transform is actually derived from the Fourier sine integral and Fourier cosine integrals. So let us look at the proof or the statement of the Fourier sine and cosine transform. So as we know that the Fourier sine integral, that is f of x, is given by 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity sine x du integral 0 to infinity ft sine ut dt. So now what we are going to do, we are going to split this 2 by pi into two parts. So we have taken the under root of root 2 by pi and the square, such that it does not make any difference. So we associate root 2 by pi with one integral and another root 2 by pi with the another integral. So we get root 2 by pi 0 to infinity sine of sx dx into root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft sine st dt, where we have replaced our u by s. So what we get now, we substitute for this value, that root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft sine st dt is taken to be f of s. So what we get that f of x is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity sine of sx ts into f of s, where f of s is called the Fourier sine transform. And you can see here, this f of s can also be written as f subscript s of f of x, where the Fourier sine transform is applied on the function itself, which is also represented by this f of s. So it can be written as it is equal to root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft sine st dt. So this is the same formula here, f of s. And what we get in the resultant for f of x, where f of x is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity f of s sine sx into ds. So this is the function. So this function f of x is called the inverse Fourier sine transform of f of s. So in this way, we are able to calculate the Fourier sine transform from the Fourier sine integral. Similarly, if you look at the Fourier cosine transform, which is derived from the Fourier cosine integral. So the Fourier cosine integral was initially derived, which was having the formula that f of x is 2 by pi 0 to infinity cos u x du into 0 to infinity ft cos u t dt. So again, we split up our 2 by pi into two parts. We associate root 2 by pi with one integral and root 2 by pi with the another integral, and we are replacing our u by s. Again, this bracketed term root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft cos of st is now written as fc of fx, which is also called as f of s. So we get f of x is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity cos sx ds into f of s. So f of s is the Fourier cosine transform of fx. So f of s is also equal to fc of fx root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft cos st dt. So f of x is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity cos sx fs ds. So fx is called the inverse Fourier cosine transform of f of s. So always remember that we have split our root 2 by pi into two parts as root 2 by pi, root 2 by pi, and this root 2 by pi factor is associated both with f of s and f of x, whereas some authors associate 2 by pi with either the Fourier transform or with the inverse Fourier cosine transform or sine transform. So different authors use different notations, but I suggest that it is better to associate the constant factor root 2 by pi with both the Fourier transform as well as the inverse Fourier transform, so that the symmetry is maintained. So in this way, we are able to calculate the formula for the Fourier sine transform and the Fourier cosine transforms and their inverse Fourier sine transform and the inverse Fourier cosine transform. Now we shall be solving the numericals related to the Fourier sine transform, Fourier cosine transforms. There would be some important results which would be used for the derivation of the calculation of the numericals, which is important to be remembered. So do remember that 0 to infinity sine ax by x dx is equal to pi by 2. This is the standard result which can be used when calculating numericals. Similarly, we have another result that 0 to infinity e to power minus x square dx is root of pi by 2. Another standard result is that integral minus infinity to infinity sine of mx upon x minus p cos 1 square plus a square dx is pi by a e to power minus a n sine of bn, where the n's are taken to be positive quantities and it is greater than 0. So these three important results are very important during the solving of the numericals of the Fourier transforms, either it be the Fourier sine or either it be Fourier cosine or the Fourier transforms. So we have some trigonometry results also being used in our numericals, that is sine c plus sine d is 2 sine c plus d by 2 cos of c minus d by 2. Similarly, we have sine c minus of sine d as 2 cos of c plus d by 2 into sine of c minus d by 2. The other trigonometry results are cos of a plus minus of b is cos a cos b minus plus of sine a sine b. The positive negative signs gets inverted by applying the cos of a plus minus of b. But when we apply the sine of a plus minus b, it is sine a cos b, where the positive negative signs takes the same form where what is in the sine of a plus minus of b into cos a sine b. Similarly, we have cos c plus cos d to be equal to 2 cos c plus d by 2 cos of c minus d by 2, and cos of c minus cos d is 2 sine of c plus d by 2 into sine of c minus of d by 2. Then we have that the recurrence formula for the integral e to power ax and ax dx is equal to e to power ax a square plus b square a sine bx minus a y cos bx. Similarly, for the integral e to power ax cos bx dx is e to power ax upon a square plus b square a cos bx plus b sine of bx. We have a formula for the integration by parts, that integral uv is u into first integral of v minus first differentiation of u into double integral of v plus double differentiation of u into triple integral of v minus of triple integration triple differentiation of u into 4 times integral of v and so on. If you have the function to be even and odd function and we are integrating the limits from minus a to a, so we have the result that integral minus a to a fx dx is 0 if the function is odd, and it is 2 times integral 0 to a fx dx if our function is assumed to be the even function. So depending upon the type of the function, whether it is even or odd, and if the limits are from minus of a to a or it is from minus infinity to infinity, the limits are having the same magnitude but opposite signs, then it could be simply written as that it is 0 if it is odd function and it is 2 times the integral a 0 to a fx dx if the function is even. Similarly, we have an important property for the Fourier sine and cosine transforms, that if we apply the Fourier sine transform on the function of x multiplied with f of x, then it is nothing but simply the minus derivative with respect to f of Fourier cosine transform of that function. Similarly, if we are applying the Fourier cosine transform on the function which is x times of fx, then it is d by ds of f of s of the function, means that we have to take the derivative but the Fourier cosine is now replaced by Fourier sine. Similarly is the case when we are applying Fourier sine on x fx, the Fourier sine is then replaced by Fourier cosine, but we have to take the derivative with respect to s. In the Fourier sine, there is a negative sign associated with it, but in the Fourier cosine transform, there is a positive sign in the derivative of the Fourier sine graph. So next we have important result, which is the gamma, a definition of the gamma function. So we have that integral e to the power minus t, t to the power n minus 1 dt is represented as gamma n. So these important results may be remembered by each of the students, so that it is very useful for you when solving the numericals related to Fourier sine or Fourier cosine transforms. So let's begin solving the numericals related to the Fourier sine and Fourier cosine transforms. So first of all, we have to find the Fourier sine transform on the function that is x e to the power minus of x squared by 2. So now we can see here that e to the power minus x squared by 2 is multiplied by x. So our function is x times a factor. So what we can say here, we can say here that we can use our property that Fourier sine of x of fx, such that this f of x can be regarded to be the exponential of e to the power minus x squared by 2. So if we apply this property, we have already studied that if there is f of s of x fx, it can be written as minus of derivative with respect to s on the Fourier cosine transform on the function. So f of c of s can be written as minus d by ds of fc of fx, where our fx will be now e to the power minus of x squared by 2. So by using this property, what is happening basically that we have covered up about x, that we are able to eliminate the factor of x while solving our Fourier sine or Fourier cosine transform. So this is the basic use of applying this property. So now the function is just one term, that is the exponential e to the power minus x squared by 2. So we have this, that for the s of x fx and minus of d by ds of Fourier cosine transform of fx. So applying the Fourier cosine transform, the definition of the Fourier cosine transform, which is root 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus x squared by 2, this is our function. It is multiplied by the common cos of sx into d of x. So we have to convert our cos of x in terms of the exponential functions. So we have written it as the real part of the equation, that is 0 to infinity e to the power minus x squared by 2 e to the power iota sx dx. We know that e to the power iota theta is cos theta plus iota sine theta. Since cos is the real part of the expansion of the cos of iota theta, so we have written this as cos of sx as the real part of e to the power iota sx. So now what we are going to do, we are going to club the exponentials by using the property that the very same powers are added. So we have clubbed the exponentials, we get e to the power minus x squared by 2 plus iota sx. Now we take minus half power, we get x squared minus of 2 iota sx, and to make it the whole square, we have added and subtracted iota s ka whole square. So we get this term, that e to the power minus half x minus iota s ka whole square, and the left out term is written as e to the power minus iota s square into dx. Now, since the integration is to be carried on the x variable, and we can see this exponential is not carrying any x variable, so this is treated as constant and it can be taken out of the integral. So this equation is written as minus d by ds root 2 by pi real part of e to the power minus s square by 2 integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus x minus iota s whole square by 2 into dx. We have deliberately used this negative sign outside our whole square, because in the limits we have the limit of infinity. So because there is an infinity term present in the limits of the integral, so it is always advisable to take this negative sign common, because e to the power minus infinity is always zero. Otherwise, if you are not taking this negative sign common, our answer will be not defined. So now we make a substitution that x minus of iota s by root 2 is taken to be y, such that dx is root 2 into dy. So what we get now, so we get that root 2 by pi real part of e to the power minus s square by 2 integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus y square dy into root 2. So it is minus of d by ds of root 2 by pi real part of e to the power minus s square by 2 into root 2 into root pi by 2. We have now the result of the integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus y square d by to the root of pi by 2. So upon solving and taking the differentiation of e to the power minus s square by 2, we get the result as s times e to the power minus s square by 2. So this is the numerical derivation of the numerical, that is a Fourier sine transform of x times e to the power minus x squared by 2. To solve the numericals, there are many other methods on which we can go on solving the numerical. So this is one of the methods how to solve the Fourier sine transform of x e to the power minus x squared by 2. So we have used the property here to solve it. Without using the property also, we can solve the same numericals. So I leave that part on your side. So let us now discuss another problem related to the Fourier sine cosine transforms. So we are given here that the Fourier sine transform is pi by 2. And we have to find the f of x. Means if we want to find the f of x, we have to apply the Fourier inverse sine transform. So using the formula for the Fourier inverse sine transform, we have root 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of s sine sx dx. So this f of s will take the value of pi by 2 because f of s is given to be pi by 2. So we substitute the value f of s to be pi by 2 and we assume a property of sine sx that sine of minus theta is minus of sine theta. So we have taken a negative sign common here outside the integral and the sine sx is replaced by sine of minus sx. So now we use the property that e to the power iota theta can be expanded as e to cos theta plus iota sine theta. So we are writing it the sine of minus sx to be the imaginary part of e to the power minus iota sx. So why did we convert this sine sx to be sine of minus sx? Because we were going to convert this sine sx as exponential term. And since there is an infinity term in the limit of the integrals, so we had to take a negative sign here. So that was the reason to convert the sine of sx to be sine of minus sx. So this was the logic behind converting sine sx into sine of minus sx. So we have converted the sine of minus sx to be as the imaginary part of e to the power minus iota sx. And why did we change into exponential? We changed into exponential because the limit in here was infinity and sine theta is not valid for the infinity. So it was generously used that we have converted the sine part to be the exponential part. And to convert the sine into exponential, and since the infinity was involved, we took the sine sx, the argument was changed to the negative argument. So we have that this is now equal to minus of root pi by 2 imaginary part. Integral is being solved, so we get the result as e to the power minus iota sx upon minus iota x, and limits are from 0 to infinity. So applying the limits, we get it as e to the power minus infinity plus e to the power 0 upon minus iota x. Since the integral is over the ds, s variable, so the constant terms that we need, that will be minus of iota x. Please make this point that in the numerator it will be minus iota x and not minus iota s. Student makes these problems, these small mistakes, that please look what is the variable on which the integration is to be solved. So it is imaginary part of e to the power minus infinity plus e to the power 0 by iota x. Since e to the power minus infinity is 0, so the first term vanishes and we are left out with e to the power 0 upon iota x and e to the power 0 is 1. So 1 by iota is nothing but minus iota by x. So taking the imaginary part which is minus 1 by x and there is a negative sign also outside. So the answer comes out to be root pi by 2 by x. So let's see the next numerical. That we have to show that the Fourier sine transform of e to the power minus ax minus of e to the power minus px upon x is given by tan inverse s by a minus tan inverse of s by b. So what we see that in the results we have this, but some constant term is not there. So I have already mentioned that some authors are associating root 2 by pi with Fourier sine transforms, and some authors are not taking the root 2 by pi. So in our answer, what we shall calculate will be associated with the term of root of 2 by pi. So different authors have different results regarding this constant value. So now, since we have to apply the Fourier sine transform, so we have taken the Fourier sine transform formula, which is equal to root 2 by pi 0 to infinity fx sine of sx dx. So our function is this function that is exponential e to power minus ax minus e to power minus bx by x. So we have substituted the value here in the f of x, and we have the result that it is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity e to power minus ax minus e to power minus bx upon x sine of sx into dx. Now this type of question is solved with a different approach, because here what we have three terms of x. One is the exponential term, one is sine of sx, and the third is having an x in the denominator. So what we are going to try is going to eliminate the x in the denominator. So for the elimination of x in the denominator, what we do, we try to differentiate our function f of s with respect to s. So when we shall differentiate with respect to s, then what happens that there would be an x in the numerator which cancels the x in the denominator, and we shall be left out with only two terms containing the x variables. So by using this approach, we differentiate both sides of the above expression with respect to s. So please take this step into consideration. So now differentiating with respect to s, what we get d by ds of f of s is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity e to power minus ax by x e to power minus bx upon x, and differentiation is to be carried over the s variable, but the sine of sx is the only one term which is containing this s variable. So the differentiation is carried only the sine sx term. So upon differentiation, we get x cos of sx into dx. So we get that this x is getting cancelling the denominator x. So we get e to power minus ax cos sx dx minus, if I go 0 to infinity, e to power minus bx cos sx dx. So we can apply the difference relation from e to power mx cos nx dx. So we have applied here that e to power minus ax upon a square plus s square into our a is minus a, so it is minus a cos sx plus b is our s, so it is s cos of s sine of sx. Similarly, on the second integral, we have e to power minus bx upon b square plus s square, which is minus b cos sx plus s sine of sx, and we have to apply the limits from 0 to infinity. So the final limit of infinity and 0 will get the result as e to power minus infinity minus 1 upon a square plus s square minus of a plus 1 by b square plus s square into minus of b. So we get the result here, and we are plugging the value. So we get root 2 by pi a upon a square plus s square minus b upon b square plus s square. Now this was the result what we had got for d by ds of f of s, but we wanted to find the f of s, so we have to eliminate this derivation. So to eliminate the differentiation, we are now going to integrate our equation with respect to s, because we have already carried out the differentiation over s. So now, so upon integrator with respect to s, we get integral d by ds of fs of s ds is f of s into s, which is root 2 by pi integral a upon s square plus a square ds minus integral b upon s square plus b square ds. So this is nothing but the value of the tan inverse of s by a. So we get root 2 by pi tan inverse s by a minus of tan inverse of s by b. And we know that when s is 0, if we substitute the value of s equal to 0, so we know that sine of 0 is 0. If we integrate sine 0 also, we get 0. So our f of s will come to be equal to 0. So from here we are taking the result that if s is equal to 0, then our function f of s is 0. So the left hand side f of s is 0, and here also it is 0. So what we get that the value of the sec constant involved in the integration is taking the value to be equal to 0. So f of s is 0, or tan inverse s by a minus tan inverse s by b is also 0. So constant value is taking to be 0 value. So substituting the value of c equal to 0 in this equation, we get the value of f of s, which comes out to be root 2 by pi tan inverse s by a minus tan inverse of s by b. So let's take a quick recap of whatever formulas we have derived so far. So the first formula we had derived was what the Fourier integral theorem, where the function could be expressed as 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity lambda integral from minus infinity to infinity ft cos of u of t minus x dt over u. For the Fourier integral theorem, we derived the Fourier sine and cosine integrals, which took the shape that f of x could be expanded as 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity sine u x du into integral 0 to infinity ft sine ut dt. So this was expressed as Fourier sine integral because it was involving the term of the sine factors. Similarly, we had the term that f of x is 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity sine u x du into integral 0 to infinity ft cos ut into dt. And this formula was regarded as the Fourier cosine integral because the terms here are now involving the terms of cos terms. So this is the Fourier cosine integral. Another way to express our Fourier integral was to express in the Fourier complex integral, where the f of x was 1 by 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity e to power minus iota u x du integral minus infinity to infinity ft e to power iota u t into dt. So this was the Fourier complex integral, and in this lecture we have derived the Fourier transforms. So we have that f of fx is f of s, which is written as 1 by 2 pi integral minus of infinity to infinity ft e power iota st dt, and our reverse Fourier transform as f of x, which is 1 by root 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of s e power minus iota sx dx, where we had just split our 1 by 2 pi into two parts, and we had associated this 1 by root 2 pi with root of the exponentials in the Fourier complex, and for the one of the integral, this integral was written as f of s. So this was the value for the f of s, and the remaining what is left is your inverse Fourier transform, that is f of x. In this way we get the formula for the Fourier transform from the Fourier complex integral. Similarly, today we have derived the Fourier sine transform and Fourier cosine transform using the results from the Fourier sine integral and the Fourier cosine integral. So today what we did, we split this 2 by pi into two parts by under root 2 by pi associating with one integral and root 2 by pi with the another integral, and taking this root 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity ft sine ut to be the f of s, which is written as f of s is fs fx, which is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity ft sine st dt. And similarly, the Fourier inverse sine transform is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity f of s sine of sx dx. Similarly, from the Fourier cosine integral, we get the Fourier cosine transform, where f of s is f of c of fx, which is root 2 by pi ft cos of st dt. And yet inverse Fourier cosine transform is f of x is root 2 by pi 0 to infinity cos sx fs into ds. So this is a quick recap of all the formulas of the Fourier transforms that we have derived so far. So I hope by using these formulas you are able to solve the numericals related to the Fourier integral theorem, Fourier sine and cosine integrals, it could be Fourier complex integrals, or you can solve the numericals related to the Fourier transforms, or for the Fourier sine transform or the Fourier cosine transform. So, thank you, and I hope that you are getting the point of what is going to explain in our lectures, and thank you so. So, have a nice time.